author, story teller, creative thinking trainer, footballing evangelist, dealer in hope, pundit with emphasis on pun.
Welcome, Vinay. Great to have you on my show, Jagged with Jastravi. Your entire focus on figuring out what is the creative process. For years you have understood that and figured out what are the key pillars, how to use sports, humor, movies for creativity. And there's a whole wealth of understanding there. And of course, you take workshops to help people think creatively. If you could share, about the three key pillars here or about your creative process here that all of us can, our audiences definitely can learn from.
So my journey has been to add a sense of vitality, energy, and fun in thinking. So to begin with, whenever the word thinking is mentioned in conversations, it's very sad that we treat it as a bit of a laborious and tedious process. And the best metaphor that I can give you for that is Rodin's thinker. If you look at that poor guy, while it's a great sculpture, it's as if he's not having much fun during the process. Put in Dehati terms, it's almost like उसका दिमाग का दही हो रहा है, right? So why couldn't thinking be like the laughing Buddha, wherein you laugh and you reach enlightenment as well? That was my starting premise. And over the last 10 years, I get into rooms where I inspire people to rediscover the creative potential in themselves. And the word rediscover is very important here because all of us are born creative. As Picasso said, every child is born creative. The challenge is to remain a creative person as you grow older, right? And if you reflect back on your own childhood, you will see that there were a lot of times you did so many creative things. But as you grew older, you began to censor yourself. You began to stop looking outside the window, to use another metaphor. You got very claustrophobic and focused in the room that you were in. So my focus is to bring you back to that kind of a mindset. And essentially, I look at three pillars which do this. So I'll go through each of them in detail, with giving you some interesting examples. The first is look for more answers. Now, the thing with us in thinking is, and you will see this a lot in your own life when you do brainstorms, the moment we reach a solution, everybody's happy. People instantly leave the room on a euphoric note. In many ways, that's where I begin my work. In many ways, because most people are talented enough to come up with one solution at least, right? Professionals are good enough to come up with one solution, whatever the problem it is that they are dealing with. But perhaps it's a conditioning of our examination mentality that we think there is one right answer for something. Now, life is not black and white, it's largely gray. So, and especially in this world of branding, marketing, advertising, there is always more than one right answer. Yeah. So one of the best metaphors that I think is there in our own culture for the process of going for more answers always is Samudra Manthan from Indian mythology. So it's a very beautifully constructed story where the destination is to find Amrit or nectar. That is the solution. And then two opposing forces, which is the Devas and the Asuras, they come together and they churn the ocean. But what's interesting is, in the process of churning, a host of other solutions, seeming solutions, come up, from sacred cows, quite literally, okay, to conches, to the goddess Lakshmi, to nymphs, to Airavat, to Kalpavriksh, to Halahal, which is the exact opposite possibly of nectar. And finally, Amrit or nectar emerges. So in many ways, there's probably a divine precedent for the quest for going for more answers when you're brainstorming. No, I always look at it that way. So first thing is go for more answers. Now, let me give you a practical example. Suppose I'm in a group which is, suppose we are working on Axe, and this I'm only taking as an hypothetical example. I have nothing to do with the brand. And suppose we end the session on a seeming solution which sounds like the Axe effect. Okay, and everybody's happy with it. Now, that's where I come in. I'll start playing around with things. So what if it was the Axe defect? Now, when you said Axe defect, it's a completely interesting but different idea. Suppose you called it the tax effect. Suppose you called it the fax effect. Fax effect means your charisma has been transmitted across a great distance. Now, I don't know whether these are tenable or workable. What I'm just trying to give you are examples. What you have to do is when you reach one solution, the most, it's very likely that you have two or three waiting close behind. And it's very important to embrace the spirit of play when you do that. So first pillar, go for more solutions. The second pillar that I believe in is learn to pause and reflect on things. Now, many of us, we tend to live life like, you know, we are in a divine rush to tick things off of some kind of an imaginary job list. So I've finished reading all the hot books there are. I've seen all the trending movies, you know. It's not about how many books you read. It's about what that book does for your thinking, which is more important. And that's why pause and reflect. Don't be satisfied with just completing something. You need to see, you need to integrate it in your thinking. And waiting after a moment and trying to reflect on what happened is a great way to improve your creative thinking process. Again, an example, 30 years ago, there was this movie which I think many people might have forgotten. It was called Love. There was Salman Khan and Revathi in it, right? And it, in many, on many fronts, it wasn't really that that popular a movie. But I'd seen it that time, and one instance stuck in my mind. Now, in the movie, Salman Khan is a struggling singer and he's come to perform on stage at an event. And the chief guest of this event is a mantri, basically a minister, and a rather unkempt one at that, very rude. Now, when he begins trying to sing, Salman's focus and idea and intent is to impress that minister. But because he discovers very early, just as he's warming up itself, the minister is not even paying attention. He's talking to everybody else around him very loudly and rudely. Salman decides that I need to metaphorically slap this guy on the face. I can't do it actually, but I need to do it in some manner that he needs to be shown his place. So instead of singing the song he has come to sing, what he quickly goes through in his mind is, what song can I sing? If I sing that, that means he just has to pay attention to me. And he sings the national anthem, right? And the point is beautifully made because even the minister has to stand up and listen to what this man has come to do, right? So pause and reflect. And whenever you look at a movie, after the movie is over, sit back, even if the movie has been terrible. And I know that 80% of what you will be watching will be terrible. But even in ordinary movies or in ordinary shows, there will always be one moment where you feel there is something different which happened. There is something I can learn from this, right? So if you develop the attitude of looking at movies like that, looking at books like that, you will see that your so to speak, creative reservoir will be far wider. You'll have many more references to borrow from. Right. The third step is momentary suspension of judgment. Now, since we are in India and everybody sees Bollywood, we are very well versed with the momentary suspension of disbelief. Right. the hero goes out of the room. He applies a pencil mustache and he comes out of the room and his mother doesn't recognize him. Right. And that's a common trope in Bollywood. And we take it as given in many ways. But what is momentary suspension of judgment? It means hold on to your judgment as long as you can. Because I've seen this a lot in brainstorms. The way people most often react is when they say, yes, but. They say, yes, but. Right? It's a very instantaneous reaction when they hear somebody else offer an idea. And the yes is out of politeness, but the but is what they really mean. They will come up with reservations against the idea. And I try and get people to leave their buts behind. And I'm not saying this in an anatomical sense of the word. Okay. I am trying to make them less cynical and more, let's say, optimistic about the overall process. So instead of yes, but, what I tell them is try and do yes, and. What that does is it forces you to see some value in the idea if you're going to talk. For instance, if you are trying to work on the concept of a new coffee cafe and somebody comes up with the idea, you know, this is a coffee cafe where no one is allowed inside. Now, it might not seem such a great idea, but because you have set a parameter like that, the next person has to add to that idea which is already on the table. So he'll say, yes, that's interesting. And what could happen is that the cafe could come to people. Now, that's a little more interesting, but it only happened because somebody was willing to jump off someone else's idea and build on it. So momentary suspension of judgment. You know, there are two parts to this. One part is when you are in social situations where the natural instinct is to criticize other people's ideas, especially in highly competitive, business or management meetings. But the corollary and the other part of that is we are also very self-critical. Many a times we censor ourselves. And that gets to be a little difficult. You know, many a times you will find yourself saying, oh, that will never go through. The moment you find yourself saying that, oh, that will never go through, just hang on to that idea a little more and try and develop it a little further. Because there is, I think, killing the inner cynic within you is what will take you the longest way when it comes to being a creative person. So those are three basic pillars. And it's not necessary that you get better at all of them at one instance. Even if you pick up one of them, say the instinct of going for more than one answer and develop it over time, you will definitely become a better creative thinking person.
Very nice, Vinay. These are very tangible tools that anyone can work for.
Thank you.
And, you know, benefit. This is like, anybody can just adapt and adopt it right now, right away. Now, you've talked about movies and you've talked about sports, but particularly if you just look at movies, because it is looked at as escape. So you are saying that any life incident, anything that is happening, if there are moments of reflection and we are processing and being more attentive to everything that's around, perhaps there is a mindful aspect to it and not overthinking, right, but just experiencing it, that itself becomes a very rich fodder for being creative, because that's
absolutely
very much a childlike mind state, that the playful inflow of life is being allowed, and, you know, it's
absolutely
picking up your reservoir from where you can pick up and use for your creative endeavors and live creatively, perhaps. So, would you like to share anything more about movies you have shared about sports or humor? Because I know you have looked at all these three as very important aspects of being creative. Would you like to go deeper in any of these?
Yeah, so even just to give you a parallel example, I already gave you an example from movies, but if I were to give you a parallel example from the world of sport, so when Sachin Tendulkar was emerging as a player, and, you know, he was known in Mumbai right from school level, which is, say, let's say 1986, 7, 87 onwards, people began hearing this name Sachin Tendulkar. I was keenly following his career at that point in time, being a huge cricketing fan. And while his records were one thing, I used to always read his interviews with greater interest. And one thing which struck me in all his interviews was the amount of respect he held to gentlemen in. And he used to always refer to them as this, Mr. Gavaskar and Mr. Richards. Mr. Gavaskar and Mr. Richards. That was interesting because when I began to see clips of Sachin at work, which is basically batting, it seemed to me like he had found the midpoint of these two opposing philosophies. So Sunil Gavaskar was, let's say, temperamentally very sound, technically very gifted, tremendous amounts of concentration levels the man had. And Vivian Richards was probably the diametrical opposite, extremely aggressive. Probably there has been nobody in the history of cricket who has been as out and out an aggressive batsman as Vivian Richards. And yet Sachin juxtaposed both of these ideas together and created his own unique persona, which we have seen for, you know, over 24 years, and the legend continues to linger. So even when it comes to sport, if you learn to look at it a little more observantly, if you read in between the lines, if you try and think, why did something happen? Or why is somebody successful? Why did somebody fail? You will get a lot more out of it. The second part of your question, I think, was in terms of the usage of humor. Now, again, that is something which is very close to my heart, and I've been a big proponent of trying to use humor more in business settings. And there are some benefits which are self-evident. One being humor diffuses the stress in a room. Two being it brings people closer together. As there's this very beautiful old adage, which is that the shortest distance between two people is a smile. Right? And in many ways that is true. When I hear laughter in the room, I know there is a greater bonding between the people who are there. But at a very practical level, usage of humor is fantastic, because humor necessarily is, you know, any joke is an innovation in a way. It's a creative act, because a joke sets you up in a certain direction. And when the punchline comes, it's a perpendicular shift to that direction. Right? That's where the term out of the box comes. In fact, you're going along a certain paradigm. The punchline changes the paradigm of the joke and you jump out of the box. For instance, a seminar on advanced time travel will be held 2 weeks ago. Okay.
Yeah.
So when the punchline comes, you have an aha moment. And this is something I love saying. There is a ha-ha before an aha moment. An aha moment always is where a creative solution is found. But usually there is a ha-ha before that. And you'll know that when you have done brainstorm, somebody cracks a joke, laughter erupts in the room. And then suddenly somebody pulls back and says, you know what? Maybe there's something there. Because any humor is a complete jump away from the expected situation. And you just saw that a little while back when I illustrated it by toying around with the axe effect example. It's just taking something and playing with it. So develop that attitude of playing with the solutions you have. Try and infuse humor in a room. I think one of the big mistakes people make is by thinking that we need Oscar-worthy punchlines to be a humorist. No. That is too much of a bar to set, and it does not solve the purpose. You need to say basic things which lighten the mood in the room. Basic things which lighten the mood in the room. That works at a starting level. I was at a multi-agency pitch for a very big client, and we had never met that client. So there were a few of us, and he was alone in that room, except that he had some support staff around. And since we had never ever met him, and because everything was running late, we had already begun presenting, and you know, time was tight. So it was a very somber interaction. At that point in time, the tea came into the room. And I was talking. I was the guy presenting for the agency. So I was talking. So the gentleman on the other side, who was the prospective client, said, you know, Vinay, your tea is getting cold. So I just, without batting an eyelid, the next thing I said was, yeah, but I'm just warming up. And he instantly laughed on hearing that. Now, it's not the best joke or any such thing. Mm-hmm. But in the, you know, the solemnity of that moment, it offered people a chance to laugh. And the moment people laugh, the barrier between you and them is less. It is less. And we ended up winning that business. And I would even cite that because of that moment did play a very large part in helping us, you know, interact with him in a far more decisive manner.
So now there are two aspects of what you've said that we will take forward. One is story. You know, like somewhere I read that what is more true than truth itself? And the answer was story, you know. And I really liked how in the beginning you talked, took an example from our mythology, Vinay, that in our mythology, there is whole lot of richness, and we are so used to dealing with ambivalence and open stories that we can interpret ourselves, you know, take learnings and make sense of it. So in terms of storytelling and in terms of humor, if you could, you know, let us know, because you've been in advertising for so many years, you could take some examples and tell us from your perspective, which two brands have used this very effectively, storytelling and humor.
If I start with storytelling, for instance, I think one brand which sticks out in my mind, which has endured over the years because, you know, it has stayed relevant because it has always touched upon the right mini tales and the subplots, is James Bond. Okay, because James Bond has been around for 70 odd years. It's been played by 6 different people. It's been spanning about nearly 30 films now. But what's interesting is while the primary idea of James Bond, I think, still is, let's say, the ultimate male fantasy, you know, at a certain level, it's that. It has nuanced itself very well across the years. And you can see that in terms of who were the villains in the earlier James Bond films and who are the villains now. So in the earlier James Bond films, it was always implied the Russians were villains, though it was eventually a Spectre or some other organization like that. Mm-hmm. But these days, the threat of terrorism is much more. That's how their stories have changed. The second is the role of women in James Bond. And none symbolizes this more than M. Now, you know, 20 years, 30 years back, to think that Bond would take orders from a woman was, you know, if you see the earlier Sean Connery movies, they are made in a certain tone. So it's very difficult to even see Bond answering to a woman in that era. But with Pierce Brosnan coming in, and M being Judi Dench, it shows a complete shift in not just, I think, Bond, but in the way the world began accepting women at higher positions of power in business and across other human endeavors. Mm-hmm. And I think she played it absolutely brilliantly. And she always was in control of Bond at all points in time. Even the way they have nuanced Moneypenny, who at one point in time was, you know, just that, you always had that moment where either a Sean Connery or a Roger Moore would flirt back and forth with Moneypenny, and it was nothing more than that. But in the later Daniel Craig movies, what you see is that she is a far stronger person. She knows what she wants in life, and she's not somebody who can be, you know, casually played with. Or while she flirts, it's a very equal relation between her and Bond. And the one more interesting aspect that I find in Bond is the way the role of Q has changed. Again, reflective of the changing time. Because across most of the eras, Q was an older man. And age and white hair meant wisdom, meant you had come a certain way. But the new Q is a young guy. And it's very reflective of the startup culture which is going across the world, where people who are in their teens and 20s are starting up massive companies, right? So Bond, while it stayed somewhere true to its overarching narrative, found stories which always were reflective of changing times. And stories need not necessarily mean major plot lines. They would mean smaller relationship and culture referencing stories like the ones I have mentioned. So I think this is one brand that has done brilliantly in terms of storytelling across time. If I look at humor and storytelling, the brand that I think has done this the best in India, or at least something I feel that they have done this very well, is Amul Butter. Now, Amul Butter, what I love about it is it has been beautifully consistent in the way it has communicated over the last 30 odd years. I remember lines from, let's say, the 80s and 90s, like when Diego Maradona won the World Cup for Argentina in 86. The Amul ad said, "Marad hona to aisa hona," right? And from puns of that time to puns of today, which they're doing with Trump, "Bill aisa kisi ne mera toda." You know, I think that there was a recent one a few months ago. They have stayed remarkably consistent, and they have consistently used humor in their narrative. I think, as an aside, another brand which I particularly like and I think will stay the test of time is the way R.K. Lakshman looked at Indian life. I would highly recommend that you subscribe to Jagged with Jasravi, because it is a hotbed of great content which offers some really interesting insights if you have interests in marketing, branding, advertising, or generally any sort of good content, because I think this kind of content is what keeps us going during these difficult periods. And a big kudos to Jasravi for creating such a wonderful stage where people can come and get entertained and inspired. That's what we all need.
Thank you. Thank you so much. It was wonderful to have you, Vinay.
Thank you
for finding time and sharing.